Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Israel has a right to try and target those civilians.
Yes, we can. Yes,
1, 2, 3.
You have meddled with the primal forces of nature, Mr. Beale, and I won't have it. You think you merely stopped a business deal? That is not the case. The Arabs have taken millions of dollars out of this country, and now they must put it back. It is ebb and flow. There are no nations, there are no peoples, there are no nations, there are no Arabs, there are no third worlds, there is no West. There is only one holistic system, our system.
You get up on your little 21-inch screen and howl about America and democracy. There is no America. There is no democracy. There is only IBM and ITT and AT&T and DuPont, Dow, Union Carbide, and Exxon. Those are the nations of the world today. We no longer live in a world of nations and ideologies, Mr. Beale. The world is a business, Mr. Beale. It has been since man crawled out of the slime.
Welcome to the Eschaton Review, a podcast that's been having human moments in World War III since 1983. Suspended 250 miles above sea level in my extremely above-ground bunker, I bear witness to the full scope of the planet every 93 minutes. I cycle through 16 sunrises and 16 sunsets every 24 of your Earth hours, peer out of my porthole and contemplate the events below. Compile them into these transmissions, which I disseminate every 112 orbits, or one Earth week for you terra firma freaks out there. As I now take a peek at my former planet, all of Europe is visible, along with a large swath of the Asian continent and Africa. This all resolves itself within the irreducible qualia of my consciousness, this tangled jungle of mystery between the ears. This week, our timestamp comes from the land of occupied Palestine, or as Lindsey Graham calls it, Israel, where it is currently 11:05 a.m., Thursday, October 24th, year of our Lord, 2024. As I take a look at my monitor here and zoom in further upon this land, well, here's a peek behind the curtain. I did a little sleuthing on the old map before I got on the microphone and wanted to see what kind of places and what kind of reviews from regular Joes, your everyday citizens, I might be able to find. And first, I was in Tel Aviv, just kind of poking around. Ended up finding something called Legalize, capital I-L. And upon further inspection, revealed itself to be... It says it's currently open 24 hours. I believe this is just some government, or non-government organization that is trying to legalize cannabis, but it's got solid reviews, 5 stars average from 19 reviews, and it's just a bunch of people saying, yeah, legalize it. That's literally the first one. just legalize it, and the owner likes to respond to every review. Ben, you are the man. Sunglasses guy, emoji, devil horns, rock and roll hand emoji. Shlomo Sheroff, 5 stars, says, weed for, then a space, ever. Response from the owner. After all, it's always 420 somewhere. Smiling emoji. Four-leaf clover emojis. Okay. Is that the stand-in for like a weed emoji that they don't have? And so there was that. That's right there on the beach, you know, Tel Aviv. It's a nice beachfront property. It was so kind of the non-existent Palestinians who lived there before to, gift it to them. Poking around further, I found a restaurant called Fish, which just that alone kind of made me laugh. The utter lack of imagination. If you guessed this was a seafood restaurant, you were correct. Now this one, being the negative Nelly I am, I went straight for the 1-star reviews, and boy howdy, there's some stories in there of terrible service, awful food. A lot of complaints about the staff, more than anything, it seems like. Yeah, the food is actually sort of like, well, some people say it's horrible. One review I like here, 1 star from Yaakov Reyes. They just wrote the word bed, B-E-D. Complaint about the food not being kosher. Oh yeah, this is like a very religious person. That was their main complaint. This place, shame! Lots of exclamation points. The place is not kosher. It is well known that the seashores stink here in the Holy Land. Unbelievable. These are all translated from Hebrew, by the way, to be fair. Translated by Google auto-translate. Our grandfathers were slaughtered in Europe. That came out of nowhere. Jeez. For those who gave their lives to fulfill the mitzvot. I don't know what that is. I'm sorry. Mitzvot of the Torah. And here they open restaurants that trample and trample and even take pictures and brag about it. Simply an indescribable shame. Save your soul and repent as long as possible. Bye. They just ended with a lowercase bye and then like a screaming emoji face. Another funny thing I noticed sorting through various Google reviews is there are a lot of people who don't seem to understand how the star system works, apparently, because there would just be like totally positive reviews that were not being sarcastic. Like they were just like boring, genuine, like the food was nice, it was good or whatever, and they just give them 1 star, kind of like that. Another common theme in the complaints is that this restaurant will like try to get you in and out as fast as possible, and they'll constantly remind you of like how much time you have left, because like they'll put you on a time limit. It seems annoying. Several complaints of this place smelling of sewage, and oh yeah, this is the one. A terrible place with the smell of sewage. The place is aware of the problem and still seats people outside. We asked the waitress. She said that she knows, but it's in the treatment we requested. This is part of the deal, alright? You get sewage smell. You signed up for this. You knew. The manager said she didn't understand what it was about, and it smelled like a fly trap. Huh. Something's lost in translation or cultural differences here. She has something to do with that. A lot of people are sitting and eating. Seems rude. Apparently this place is located in an industrial area as well. That's when you're also like, it looks like maybe you could probably walk to the beach from this place in, I don't know, 10, 15, 20 minutes. It's kind of hard to tell just on the map here, but yeah, it's unfortunate. Oh, this was the particularly bad one, but my god, it's a fucking epically long one. There's a lot of preamble here that can be disregarded. This is Valentine's Day. The only time they could get in was 10:30 at night. I mean, this is kind of on you guys. Like, go to another fucking place, Jesus. Arriving at the restaurant, I smelled a strong smell of fish, which I had never experienced before. I mean, fish smell at a seafood restaurant, I don't know. It's not the craziest thing. Sewage is another deal, but it was very dirty. Pieces of broken glass were lying under our table, and in general, the floor was not cleaned throughout the entire restaurant. But they decided that there was too much influx. Although, for an, quote, elite restaurant, this cannot serve as an excuse. But, ellipses, we, as in our visit last week, we decided to duplicate our order because last time everything was excellent and very tasty. In short, we ordered eggplant cream, sounds gross, and the main course, a seafood cocktail, a glass of wine, and a glass of beer. My husband had already eaten a few pieces from the cocktail. Everything was fine, and I took the first mussel, and oops, it turned out to be just rotten, with a terrible smell and taste. We called the waitress and said that we would not touch anything else because, ellipses, a lot of unnecessary ellipses here. I simply couldn't eat after that. I could barely restrain myself so that, excuse me, I wouldn't throw up. And what they did to us, they took the dish from us and brought us the bill for the eggplants. We ate a spoonful, and wine and beer. My husband didn't even touch it. The husband said that he refuses to pay because it's not that we didn't like the dish, but it was rotten and we could simply get poisoned because, ellipses, it's also seafood. The manager and some other lady came up to us, who didn't even bother to introduce herself, and in an absolutely boorish tone, they said that their mussels were beautiful and fresh. Look, I know these are just like whatever regular people, but considering the, you know, the happenings in Israel, like, it's hard not to draw parallels. There's like larger cultural parallels here. But this like idea of like just telling you one thing when reality's right in front of you and it's so not that. It's a microcosm of a greater, more horrible thing. The food's not rotten. It's beautiful. In fact, it's the best food you've ever seen. We didn't kill all those people. Hamas made us kill all those people. So actually, Hamas killed them. That's on their head. Okay. They said that their mussels were beautiful and fresh. I invited them to just smell this mussel, or at least my hands, which smelled like rotten meat upon arriving home. They said that they were not asking us to pay for this dish, but only for everything else. I asked my husband to pay because, ellipses, I didn't want to end up ruining our evening with a showdown, and then we left, having heard, quote, be healthy as a mockery. Pretty rude. We understand that everyone is human and anything can happen, the human factor, etc. You could at least apologize and certainly not take money. In decent establishments, they not only don't take money from you, but also try to somehow compensate for their, quote, mistake. And they said they wish they could give it 0 stars, but they have to give it 1. Alright, enough with the reviews. I also looked into an amusement park nearby to fish called Superland, and those 1-star reviews were also quite heinous, but I'm gonna leave that to the imagination, and you can check it out for yourself. Just search Superland on Google Maps in Tel Aviv. But I wanted to see what would happen if I checked out. I was looking for the Mossad building, which I couldn't seem to find. I didn't look too hard, though. So I went to the Knesset building, and the 1-star reviews there were either, like, complaining about really dumb bullshit about the tour, or people just, like, saying, like, fuck all these politicians. So that's pretty good. And I also found Rabbi Shmuley's daughter's sex shop, the Kosher Sex Shop, which I had to, like, do a fair amount of internet-based legwork to confirm that this was actually her sex shop, because when I looked at it, it looked so shitty and small and bad. I was like, but then again, it's like, okay, yeah, Shmuley sucks. But, yeah, his daughter is terrible as well. I caught a couple of her social media posts in the process, and not any fun reviews to read about that. It actually only has 4 reviews, which is pretty sad. But yeah, it's just this like really tiny little store with like a couple of vibrators in it, basically. And I watched an interview with her talking about it. She's super proud of it. So there was that as well. And then I looked at the Wailing Wall, Western Wall, as it's is also known as. And the one-star reviews of the Wailing Wall are the funny thing that seems to be a through line with them is people complaining that there's no water, and like even on like official tours, just like so many of the reviews are just, I was so fucking thirsty. There's nowhere to get a goddamn drink of water. What kind of tour is this? I didn't get too far into that. I didn't see any real spicy takes on the Wailing Wall, as far as I remember. Of course, they're mostly five-star glowing reviews of the place. The first one-star review is one of those ones I was talking about, where they don't seem to understand the star system. One star. It was an amazing place, worthy visiting all the time. One star. Bad place. No elaboration. One star, one of the worst place in the world. One star, it is not cool. Worst place in the world, just a wall. I like that one. Rob McCormick, shout out. One star, 6 years ago, just a wall. It was awful, bad place. These all sound like Trump tweets. Bad wall restaurant, worst place, very not tremendous. And then, like I said, people complaining about the lack of water on the tours and in the area. All right, well, we're in the neighborhood of Israel, so let's hop into our first proper story. Now, since a lot of the news you get on this podcast isn't necessarily the most positive, I thought I'd start off with a good story. New Jersey journalist Jeremy Loffredo, charged in Israel with aiding the enemy, is free. So, Jeremy Loffredo, who I brought up last week, was detained very unfairly, and he and a small group of other journalists were treated quite poorly with very flimsy legal basis, we'll say. He is, I believe he is back in the U.S., or at the very least, he was given the means to go back, which was the wallet and passport and phone they had confiscated from him. So that's good. Next up, this is a story I've been champing at the bit, to use the proper expression, which is fitting for this next bit that I was excited to talk about. I tried to fit it into the last two podcast episodes and it just didn't work out, but here we go. Rationalizing the horrors of Israel's war in Gaza. The novelist Howard Jacobson has argued that too much press coverage of dead Palestinian children is a new form of blood libel against Jews. We could stop there and have so much to talk about, but why do that when we can read this motherfucker's insane, narcissistic ramblings? This shit is outrageous. I looked a little bit into this guy. I guess I'll give a little bit of what I found. So he's a novelist. He's like 80-something now. He's one of these, like, I think David Foster Wallace once called them great male narcissist novelists of a certain age and time. And they tend to just write, all of their novels are just like very thinly veiled at best. Basically fantasies that they put themselves in the center of. Their protagonists are just them, always. And they'll write, like, dozens of books. So, like, your John Updikes, your Philip Roths, who are probably way better writers than this guy, I would guess. Like, at least they could write well. I imagine, based on what I read about, like, the premises of his novels and some other op-ed writing I found of his, I'm gonna say this guy fucking sucks. Howard Jacobson. But anyway, it makes so much sense when you hear this interview that he is this just totally self-obsessed narcissist who just writes about himself, and like he's so blind to like the rest of the world. It's insane. But let's dig in. So this was an interview in the New Yorker, conducted by Isaac Choteiner. I don't know if I'm saying that right. He does a serviceable job of doing, like, I guess real journalism. He doesn't, you know, of course I would have wanted him to like really push back on this guy, but he does proper journalism where he asks just like good rational follow-up questions and stuff. But let's just hear some of it. It's a bit long. I kind of want to read all of it, but I'll probably skip around a little bit, and I'm going to skip the intro and just get right into the questions. What is it that you have wanted to get across to readers since October 7th? I was in such a... this guy's British, by the way, and I can't really do accents, but imagine this guy doing, I'm going to guess, a very posh English accent, just guessing. But I'm just going to use my voice, because, you know, whatever. I can read faster that way, probably. I was in such a confusion of fear and stress and upset, and then rage. The fear and the upset and the heartbreak was the massacre itself. And then the speed of the response to the aftermath of the massacre was so hideous, so unexpected, such a kind of topsy-turvy version of what we normally expect a response to a catastrophe to be, that it just threw me into half confusion, half fury. What the hell was going on that people could turn like that on the people who'd been attacked? See, up until then, you could maybe even think that he would be talking about the response from Israel to Palestine, the immediate response on October 7th, which was killing thousands of people within the first week of just hellfire and fury and carpet bombing. But no, that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about the reaction from the rest of the world towards Israel, which in his fucked up memory was everyone ganging up on the Jews. I don't remember it that way. Do you remember it that way? It's absolutely not what happened. There were people on like the fringes of society, like myself, who were condemning Israel's insane aggression, which is just revenge and collective punishment, which is not part of defending yourself. Let's just get that crystal clear. The only Israel has a right to defend itself thing that is actually true is that on October 7th, sure, they had absolutely the right to defend themselves from Operation Al-Aqsa Flood because, I mean... although, I mean, it's kind of debatable in a way, but let's say Israel was on its own land, its sovereign land, and that sovereign land was invaded, okay? Yes, they can defend themselves. Everything beyond that is a war crime. All right, this guy's stupid answer continues. All those people who said, no, no, hang on, don't talk about anti-Semitism, this is anti-Zionism. All that went as the people attacking Israel couldn't remember if they were attacking Jews, Israelis, Zionists. I thought, the world that I live in is not the world I knew. It's changed, and I still feel that. I'm living in a world I don't recognize and find it very hard to comprehend. Because you're stupid. You're a moron who writes shitty novels about yourself. And your probably boring sex life. Just gonna throw that out. Yeah, remember that, guys, when like the whole world and all of the Western media especially were like, no, 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 Hamas is just doing anti-Zionism. It's okay. That's what everyone was saying, right? We weren't like, I mean, I don't even know a lot of this. I don't think I even need to. Like, people who are listening to this understand what's so stupid about this guy's answers. Continuing, here's the second question. After October 7th, there was a rise in anti-Semitic incidents in many countries, but there was also strong support for Israel, including diplomatic and military support from almost every powerful Western country. Yes, that's right. Jacobson says, it was ambiguous, but certainly stronger even than what I've just suggested. And here was another extraordinary phenomenon. Suddenly, you could trust the government, but you couldn't trust the people. Governments were sound. People were flaky. Much of this irrationality was coming from institutions of higher education. That was the bewildering. And I suppose because I'm an academic at heart and was a lecturer for many years before I became a full-time writer, I looked to that. The fuck you talking about? I honestly don't even understand what governments were sound, people were flaky. Who's this you were even talking about? Get some fucking clarity in your speech. I mean, I get what you... Much of this irrationality was coming from institutions of higher education. So he's just saying, like, all the radical people on college campuses not sufficiently supporting Israel in their time of need or whatever. Question. After the war in Gaza started and there were all these civilian casualties, we saw Israel intentionally denying humanitarian aid to people who were starving. What should the response be from people? What should the response from people have been at that point? That's not something I can say because I don't know what my own response should have been. You don't know what your own response should have been? I trusted no one and I trusted no report. That doesn't mean that I didn't see some pictures on television. The BBC has been appalling. It just showed you pictures, unbearable pictures, heartbreaking pictures of dying babies every night. But any war would look appalling if you just showed the suffering of women and children. What fucking news was this guy watching? I mean, I guess I don't watch the BBC, like, a lot. No major news, like, no television news is showing, like, the truly gruesome videos and images that you see on social media. None. Not even, like, the alternative media that is, like, super anti-Zionist, you know, the kind of shit that I follow will really want to just, like, show that stuff. Because it's, I mean, people should see it. Anyway, point is, this guy is either a liar or he's, like, he's conflating, like, images of, like, people walking around rubble with, like, these more gruesome things. And also, there's this whole idea that the media, the mainstream media, has a bias against Israel and a bias, or even a bias against Jews more broadly, is the most insane. It just goes in line with that fucking review I just read about the fucking fish restaurant. No, the mussels aren't rotten and going to kill you. They're the most beautiful specimens of seafood you can ever get your hands on. Just, like, diametrically opposed visions of reality. Any war would look appalling if you just showed the suffering of the women and children. Fuck you. He goes on to say, so I thought, who am I to believe here? I read a lot of people, I believed some, and I didn't believe others. Wow, fucking insightful. You... That's what everybody does. It's turned out very badly, and the right-wing government of Benjamin Netanyahu is contemptible. Wow, you're really brave. You're so fucking brave, buddy. I have no doubt about all that, but that didn't mean that something didn't need doing. There was no alternative to it. Israel had to try to get Hamas. I thought Netanyahu's belief that he could wipe out Hamas was stupid, so I felt that this war had to be prosecuted. Let's just dwell on those two sentences back to back for a second. Netanyahu's belief that he could wipe out Hamas is stupid, therefore we have to try to wipe out Hamas. And then he says, if a war is prosecuted, it will be ugly. War is ugly. That's just all that's happening here. It's just the ugliness of war. This is not a fucking war. Okay. The interviewer says, I asked you about the specific intentional denial of humanitarian aid, and your answer was something like, well, I don't know what to believe anymore when I read the news, so I can't really comment on that. Is that right? Put quite like that, and it sounds as though what I said was stupid and ignorant. Yes! Exactly! Bang on, old chap! You fucking idiot! One got accounts and accounts and accounts, and it was very hard to know what was the truth. Interviewer? Well, just for example, the American government, which has been very supportive of Israel and has kept sending them weapons, has tacitly acknowledged that Israel intentionally denied humanitarian aid. Lots of humanitarian groups have said the same thing. Well, if Israel was doing that, then what can one feel except that it's monstrous? Yeah! But he puts the conditional on there. If Israel is doing that, I mean, I don't know what to believe. There's so much news. Who can say? I've said one has to balance these things. This thing has got to be done. Is he referring to the massacre, or as you would call it, the war against Hamas? This thing has got to be done. Did it have to be done quite so cruelly? No. Did it have to be done so... ellipses... See, I'm very worried about the indiscriminate and the disproportionate. I've got snagged up on the disproportionate argument and the indiscriminate argument. The disproportionate one I can't buy, because I don't know how you'd measure what you have to do after that massacre. We know we can't measure life for life. Why not? I don't buy the disproportionate. I don't buy it. Well, I'm convinced. He doesn't buy it because he doesn't buy it. How can we calculate? The interviewer kind of goes on to react slightly the way I would, except much more politely. Interviewer. So you're saying the idea that 1,200 Israelis were killed and now 42,000 Gazans have been killed, that comparing the two in itself is not any sort of argument? Well, all right, Isaac. What's the figure you'd choose? I was just trying to clarify what you meant. I don't know how you do the mathematics of this. And I'm not going to say the mathematics of revenge, because while of course there was an element of revenge, and you wanted it not to be revenge, you didn't want it to be a punishment either. I hated that word, punishment. I think the justification for what Israel did was to try to make sure that this never happened again. Solid, solid reasoning. Who is this genius moral philosopher? And I think that the attempt to make sure that this never happened again, the numbers are going to inevitably have to be high. If you're a terrorist, you do hide yourself in schools and hospitals. So if the Israelis are going to get you, they're going to have to attack those things. If it's a war crime to hide in a hospital, it's also a war crime to indiscriminately bomb a hospital, says the interviewer. Well, you've just used rhetoric. Indiscriminately. Well, what's indiscrimination? If you're trying to go after people who are hiding there, how do you get them if you have to be discriminant? What do you do? I mean, just an idea. Even if you want to stick with the idea that each member of Hamas must be hunted down and killed, you can't send ground troops in. You can go into the tunnels. You could be big, brave IDF man and or, you know, whatever, fashion model lady, whatever, and go in there. You can do all kinds of different military tactics that don't involve carpet bombing the entire fucking place. But numbers, mathematics of revenge, I don't understand. Indiscriminate, what is indiscrimination? What is it? The interviewer answers, you have to make a judgment about balancing civilian casualties with war. I'd like to think Israel has, in the main, done that. Have they? How would you fucking know? You don't watch the news because you think the news is blood libel. You don't fucking read about anything because you think it's all blood libel, making you feel icky that you have to feel bad about it. You don't fucking know anything, piece of shit. Interviewer, does how they have fought the war in the past year, let alone what members of the Israeli government think of Palestinians, make you think that they're going to try to do that? Do that being balancing civilian casualties with war? I would like to think Israel has done its best. Some people will laugh in my face. Ha! Yes, I will. And more. Continuing. But I haven't been convinced that they have been wildly indiscriminate. So now they've been indiscriminate, just not wildly indiscriminate. Changing your tune here pretty quickly, whatever your fucking name is, I forgot already, Jacobson. One or two people in Netanyahu's cabinet have said the most appalling things. Yeah, just one or two. You really got your finger on the pulse of what's going on in Israel, if you think that that's the case. Dumb fuck. And if they're just taken out right now, removed from government, I would be perfectly happy. The current Israeli administration has no imagination for what it might be to be a Palestinian. I feel that with a great passion. There has been cruelty in this government. But it's all justified. Everything's justifiable. Interviewer, your piece brings up the number of children being killed in Ukraine and the number of children being killed in Gaza, and you say that news coverage of the two has been very disproportionate. Yeah, that's the other thing, is he wrote some op-ed, which I haven't read yet, which was basically making the, you know, showing us dead kids hurts our feelings and is actually anti-Semitism, which led into this interview. You say the news coverage of the two has been very disproportionate. Can you talk about that? Yes, it's interesting. Of all the pieces that I've done, this is the piece that seems to upset people most. I've thought about writing it for many months, and I didn't. And then I thought, well, no, I'm going to have to do it and just risk it. And it upsets people because the minute you talk about the death of children, not only every word, but every comma is scrutinized. Oh, woe is me! Interviewer says, crazy how that works. Well, I get it, and now I think I should have trusted my own feeling at the beginning. Don't go there. But I wanted to record the experience as a Jew, and it was shared by many of my Jewish friends. Night after night after night after night after night, the BBC showed pictures of a beautiful Palestinian child alive one minute and dead the next. That is the most monstrous thing. Is it monstrous that they showed it to you, or that it happened? I can't tell because of how fucking stupid you are, he continues. We shed tears. We couldn't bear to see it. Were some children targeted? If children were deliberately targeted, that is absolutely monstrous and indisputably a war crime. If some were targeted, I just don't know. But when a plane flies overhead, it doesn't deliberately target the Jew. It cannot. There's no such plane. And there's no such pilot. And to turn the war into nothing other than the murder of children made me sick. Made me not want to trust the news. I was happy to say, this is like watching Hamas propaganda. Look what the Jews do. Look what the Jews do. Ring the bell, folks. Jews kill children. You're just describing what's fucking happening. Except people aren't saying the Jews kill children. People are saying the Israeli government and the Israeli military are killing children. Nobody is saying, look, Jews kill children. That's just what they do. It's in their DNA. That's what he's implying here. You compare this with Ukraine and asked why there was more coverage of children in Gaza. About 2,000 children in Ukraine have been injured or killed in 2.5 years of war. This year in Gaza, more than 15,000 children were killed. And my aside, that number is probably very much lower than the reality, which we'll only find out who knows how much longer down the road. But yeah, I mean, like, and the interviewer doesn't even bring up the fact that in terms of percentage, per capita, Gaza is 2.2 million people. Ukraine is something like, I don't remember off the top of my head. It's a big-ass country, folks. It's around, like, 40 million. So it's just, there's no comparison. And also, again, I don't know what fucking news this guy watches, but I would almost bet my life that there was more news coverage attention given to the plight of Ukrainian children than there has been on the plight of Palestinians. So the interviewer said, this year in Gaza, more than 15,000 children were killed. Howard Jacobson. How do we explain that? Some Ukrainian children were able to leave many of the frontline areas. Gazans, including children, are not allowed to leave. It's like talking to a child. Like, this is what Gaza is. This is what Israel does and has been doing for fucking ever. You claim to, like, give a shit about Israel. You don't know any of this? And Israel has fought an incredibly intense war that has killed a ton of children because they're not trying to avoid civilian casualties as well as they should. That's how I would describe it. And how careful do you think the Russians are to avoid civilian casualties? The numbers speak for themselves in comparison. The interviewer answers, I don't think they're being careful, and in fact, a lot of Ukrainian children have been kidnapped and taken to Russia. But you were talking about the media, and way more children have been killed in Gaza. So that would explain some of the discrepancy. The discrepancy that I contest doesn't exist between the coverage of the two. Jacobson says, why should this be a matter of numbers? Why do you need to bring maths into this? I'm not saying that the media should underestimate the number of Palestinian children killed. It's a question of whether you choose to lead every story with children killed. 45 children were killed today. 30 children were killed today. 15 children were killed today. It became an obsession. It became and still is. Maybe that's because that's how many kids are dying every day. So the news reports on it. Why do you have to focus on numbers? It's not fair, I tell you. Interviewer asks, what should be the lead story on days when lots of children are killed? I'm not talking about those days. This was every single night. I'm telling you, I saw a dead baby every single night, which means that they're being killed every day. If that's the case, if you're really seeing this on a daily basis, that's what's happening. You couldn't look at a child, pictures of children being killed every single night without thinking, this is making my people, my kin, out to be child murderers. It's almost as if your kin, if you're talking about Israelis and not just Jews, but you're actually just trying to drag this, you're trying to make this a conflation of Judaism is Zionism, is all Jews are actually Israelis, whether they know it or not. I've got two options for you. I can believe it's true. Okay, it's true. It's true. That's what we do. That's what the Israelis, not us, but the Israelis do. Yes! You're so close to understanding reality, but you're just gonna veer away from it. He continues, but we feel a kinship with the Israelis. That's what they do. And so maybe there we are again. Maybe everything they said about us in 1200 and 1300 was true. So this is where he starts dragging in the, this is just about Jews and blood libel. This is what the Jews do, kill children. I'm not going to buy it. I'm not going to buy it. Oh boy. He's determined not to believe it could possibly be true, even though he's complaining about having to see it on the news all the time. What, it's just fake? Are these crisis actors that you're seeing on the news? Interviewer comes back with a very good point here, maybe one of his best points of the interview. The interviewer says, Howard, I think maybe we're in a bit of a worrisome place. If you see photos of dead children on television, and your first thought is, they're trying to make me, a Jew, hate my people. You've twisted what I said. That's not my first thought. That's not my first thought. Second thought? And it's not my second thought. It all depends on how often you see them and when you see them. You see them and you see them, and that's all you see. And then you feel, is this what the war means to the media? This is what they want to stress again and again and again? Hey, fuckface, what should be stressed instead? And actually, other things are stressed all the time. This is the most absolute self-pitying, narcissistic bullshit. And yes, I know it's just some fucking stupid novelist, but like, he's representing like a huge mindset that's out there. This self-victimizing, fucking woe is me, this is all about me and my little feelings bullshit. I'm not saying that if all those children were being killed, he keeps doing this, if they were being killed, not they are and they have been, I'm not saying that if all those children were being killed, that we should not know about it. Yes, you are! You're saying you're sick of seeing it on the news all the time! But it's perfectly possible now for people to call Jews in the streets of London child killers. Child killers! Exactly as we would have heard 700 bloody years ago. In April, he wrote, Netanyahu is enough to try the patience of the West, whose leaders have little appetite for sticking to a mission. There is a flaw in our natures that leads to our growing bored with even the noblest causes, let alone those grown stale in their own complacency. Did you mean the mission to defeat Hamas? Yeah, I can't remember. That's a long time ago. But certainly my feeling, I think it's fairly well agreed that often the pressure has been brought on Israel to stop it now. You yourself said they weren't going to completely defeat Hamas. But I want to bring this back to what you said about the streets of London. One of the things that has been so disturbing about anti-Semitism, especially after October 7th, is American Jews or British Jews being blamed for what the Israeli government is doing. I agree this is disgusting, but it seems that this has somehow led a lot of American and British Jews, like yourself, to support whatever the Israeli government is doing. I take your argument. But it's a bit of a quagmire when you say, well, don't confuse us with the Israelis. We've got nothing to do with that. Because the next stage of that is, all the terrible things you say about Israel are allowed to be true. What? Okay, this is such tortured reasoning. I feel like I have to, like, parse it here. He's saying, if we're not allowed to just conflate Jews, global Jewry, with being Israeli, then people are allowed to talk shit about Israel when they go on murder mayhem sprees. All the terrible things that you say about Israel are allowed to be true. So if we're only... God damn it, this fucking guy. Oh, Jesus Christ. Here he goes on to get real fucking self-sucky here, just on his back like a fucking turtle, trying to get that dick in his own mouth. I castigate myself all the time. I know lots of Jews who castigate. I wake up and I think a hopeless war is over. I want it to stop. And then I castigate myself because I think that's weak. And then I wake up feeling quite different. And I want the war to be pursued. I castigate myself for feeling bloodthirsty. I castigate myself for feeling apologetic. And I castigate myself for feeling bloodthirsty. Again? Look, the war isn't about me. Look, the war isn't about me, and the war isn't about my nature. You're sure making it feel like it is. Who the hell knows what's the right thing to do? Why can't we admit that? We just don't know. That's not a carte blanche for the Israelis. If war crimes have been committed, then let them be tried when it's all clear. But at the moment, in the fog of war, the fog of war is a year later. I hear what you're saying about how tortured you are by all this, and you don't know what is to be done. No, I'm not tortured. The people who are tortured are the Jews who were tortured and the poor Palestinians. What are you talking about? What Jews were tortured? I'm just a Jew living in a safe space at the moment, watching it all, wishing it wasn't happening, but trying to distinguish what might be true from what's not true, and listening, from where I live, to the helicopters going overhead and people marching through the streets, shouting gibberish and accusing Jews of being genocidal and apartheid and child killers and the rest of it, and getting very angry, feeling unsafe, feeling sorry for Jews. You get that? People protesting in London are not accusing Jews of being genocidal. They're accusing the Israeli government and the Israeli military. You get that? Interviewer. Yeah, of course. I guess my fear is that your anger about anti-Semitism in Britain is leading you to a place where basically nothing the Israeli government can do will be seen as too far. And you may say you feel torn about it, but fundamentally you're going to support this Israeli government, whatever it does. No, I won't. No. There's no whatever it does. I don't know what they're going to do tomorrow, and I'm not prepared to say I support it. So wait, you're not prepared to say you support what they might do, but that means that you support everything they've done. Does it not? I mean, this guy just doesn't know what the fuck is happening and doesn't really care. He just, only thing he cares about is that when he watches telly, he has to see stuff that makes him sad and makes him feel like the whole world is ganging up on the poor Jews, which is insane because it's the opposite narrative that dominates, like, at least the Western world, if not beyond. Interviewer, but fundamentally you think this war should be supported and that the West should continue giving Israel weapons. Is that accurate? I think the West should continue to give them weapons because I think they are an island surrounded by enemies. They've got a lot of fights on their head. But they were just minding their own business, twiddling their thumbs, since 1948. They've got a lot of fights on their head. But just to be clear, I do not support anything that they might do. Again, he's putting this in the future tense. I do not support everything that they have done. Okay, there he goes, past tense. But I get why they have to do it. There he goes, saying he does fucking support it. I do not support everything that they have done. But I get why they have to do it, so therefore I'm supporting it. I get why they have to do it. He repeats himself a lot. Maybe it's because he's old, or because he's old and stupid. Interviewer, what are things you don't support, but that you think they have to do? Simple question, and he's just said that there are things like that that he has in his mind palace. Let's hear his answer. Well, I didn't support the whole notion from the start of going in and wiping Hamas out. That looks a bit pitiless. But how do you show pity? This is the problem. How do you show pity when you have to remove an enemy that wants you dead? Again, within the same short grouping of paragraphs, sentences. He says, I don't support the idea of wiping out Hamas, but we have to go in and wipe out Hamas. Just blatantly contradicting yourself. This is like liberal Zionism distilled perfectly. It's this whole fucking mental gymnastics that these people have to go through to like make themselves feel like they're not monstrous. To help answer his pleading kind of rhetorical question, how do you show pity? It's possible to show pity in this kind of situation. Interviewer says, I think you should show pity to civilians. Well, of course you do. And if there's any suggestion that they are, if you are telling me that you know for sure that the Israelis are going out there and they're picking off civilians for fun, picking off civilians, I agree with you. That's unforgivable if that's what they're doing. So much documentation of that being done, you just don't want to know. interviewer responds, they intentionally denied humanitarian aid to people who didn't have food. We can start there. If we know for sure that's what they did, then A, that's cruel, and B, that's stupid. This guy is a fucking moron. Except, again, imagine this all in a sort of posh English accent done by an academic, I don't know, wearing some kind of cardigan, probably. Oh, that's the other thing. If you want to see something hilarious, I should have said this at the beginning. Search Howard Jacobson images, and let's just say he looks like problematic. He looks like a real-life problematic illustration of Jews from, you know, Nazi Germany or something. Shout out Bad Hasbro Podcast. Naturally, of course, they got to this interview and it did a good job of covering it. A lot of like Cockney accents. But anyway, they look up the guy to see what he looks like, and their reaction is really funny.
Can we just show a picture of this guy for a second? I just texted you because this, again, I spoke earlier about, and this is a difficult thing to talk about, okay? But I spoke earlier about how are you, a Palestinian comedian, in a time when so many Jews are somehow
go on, man,
acting, what are you acting doing out a program of like anti-Semitic stereotypes on steroids come to life animatronically. Now, look, there is a certain physiognomy to Jews, and I'm not saying that anyone who looks like this necessarily, but can we just look at this guy?
Oh, come on! Come on, man! Dude, hold on. We all look. We can't just go into the like just looking at him.
Get it off of the fucking screen, man. What are you doing to me, man?
It's not. It's that he's not. It's that he is not an attractive man. Says nothing about us as a people, Daniel. And it says nothing about. Us as... No, you're sending me more photos. No,
the thing is, this exact physiognomy, if you changed his emotional inner world, would be a lovely, beautiful, wise-looking rabbi.
Yeah.
It's actually
exactly.
Not about the physicality, but if you look at this picture, mm-hmm. it gives off a vibes of a kind of... What's the word? Hectoring shiftiness?
Listen, that's what I see in my nightmares, fellas. I mean, yeah, it's got to...
Listen, there's not a Jew on this podcast who, with the wrong angle, can't look a little bit globe-holdy. We all, as Adam is talking about, we all can sometimes, depending on lighting, look like a merchant of somewhere.
It looks like we could easily be a merchant in some... Port
maybe
City.
Somewhere in Italy, let's say.
And they're more allowed than me to really go off on this guy's looks because they're Jewish, I guess. But he just looks like a fucking stereotype, and it adds to all of this liberal Zionist pablum that is fucking leaking out of his stupid ass slack jawed mouth. So his answer to the idea of withheld humanitarian aid. Say it one more time. If we know for sure that's what they did, then A, that's cruel, and B, that's stupid. Interviewer, I would tell you that it's been all over the news, but I feel like you're not going to trust me when I say that. Well, I don't trust. I know. That sounds as though I've just turned myself into somebody that puts his head in the sand. Yes, that's what you are. You keep saying what you are, but you're saying it like sarcastically. I'm unwilling on all sides, actually, to trust anybody at the moment. This is what I support. I support the Israeli government's attempt to wipe out Hamas. I thought you said you didn't support that, like 10 seconds ago. To kill them all. To get rid of them all. I support that. So I don't trust anybody on any side, but I support what the Israeli government tells me they need to do. Okay. You stupid old fuck. Interviewer says, despite thinking it's unrealistic, this is, again, because this guy keeps saying, I thought it was crazy that Netanyahu said we could kill all of Hamas. And here he just says, I support wiping out Hamas to kill them all, to get rid of them all. I support that. Despite thinking it's unrealistic, I want them to do the best they can. I remember Amos Oz saying about a previous war, what do you do if the people you are trying to get to, because they are trying to kill you, are holding up a child in one hand and shooting at you with another? You go wrong is what you do. You go a little bit too far is what you do. You are forced into cruelties is what you are. Yeah, fuck this motherfucker. I can watch like dozens of videos of the IDF using Palestinians as human shields. I could pull them up very easily right now. I can't find any of Hamas doing that. And the idea Hamas is using human shields because they have to fight in close proximity to the populace a lot of the time is ridiculous. And to try to characterize that as having a child in one hand and a gun in the other makes me want to fucking vomit in this fuckhead's face. All right, last question. I appreciate you taking the time to talk. I don't know how this is going to come out, but my fear is somehow or other I'm beginning to sound hysterical or overexcited or extreme. I think that I have been so thrown by the topsy-turviness of people's response to the massacre. Which massacre? Are you talking about October 7th? Fuck you. When people denied that children were killed and women were raped, that was denied. I think the attitude towards that has made me a different kind of person. There's no evidence of anyone being raped, other than on the side of the Israelis, where it's documented thoroughly, even on video that was played on Israeli media. You fucking ignorant sack of shit. Fuck off. So that's that interview, which has been driving me crazy for, I don't know, 10 days, it looks like, since this came out, and I think I read it right away. But yeah, I finally got that out of my system. So recently, there's been some coverage of what's being referred to as a Zionist settler conference, which is basically families of, quote, settlers, a term that I hate because it just, I don't know, there just needs to be a stronger word for it. So I've got a couple clips here of some of the reporting on that we'll take a listen to. I believe this was Channel 4, BBC Channel 4.
These sukkots, these temporary shelters behind me are different though. This is about 200 settler families who are intent on setting up Jewish outposts inside Gaza once this war ends. It is incongruous. It is settler Glastonbury. On one side, the sounds of families celebrating. Literally on the other side, the sound of artillery and the sound of what will result in families dying.
You won't find that kind of coverage out of America, I'm pretty confident. But yeah, they're just, the settlers are just so obviously like drooling, sharpening their forks and knives, sitting at this border. And it goes along with, you know, previously mentioned the bombing Gaza boat tours or whatever, just like so shameless about it. But now they're like literally like having like an official little gathering where they're like, yep, we're gonna move in any day now. I did appreciate the reporter at least like drawing the stark contrast between here are all these families like having a good time, like camping out basically, and like right over that way we can literally hear artillery and bombs, and you know, knowing that it's just wiping out families. There's another clip. It might have been the same interviewer, or reporter rather, but he's interviewing this really despicable guy who, again, just is very blatant about what their intentions are for Gaza and uses extremely, let's just say, Nazified language to describe Gazans. Dehumanizing language, we'll say.
In the Israeli government. That is when you have a a cut in your body, and that cut, it has an infection. You have to take out the infection. When you take out the infection, then it'll be clean again.
In terms of cleaning out this infection, as you call it, what would you like to see happen to the over a million Palestinians that live there?
I think there are many nations, including Ireland and England, who would welcome them to come and live in their...
For mass deportations to other countries.
Yeah, just like happens in Ukraine, in Russia, and any other place in the world, you have a war.
Does that idea not offend...
You have refugees.
Does that idea of mass deportations and cleansing the wound not offend your sense of Jewishness, given your people's history?
No, because when the evil is so bad, you have to do something with it, to make peace with evil.
That has very dark historical resonance, that sentence you've just said, in terms of Jewish people.
Right now, the dark I know was what happened a year ago here in Sderot. That was very dark.
Okay, so he first tries to almost make it sound like the mass deportation of all Gazans, and what he really means is all Palestinians, period. You know, West Bank included, is akin to, like, people getting refugee status from Ukraine and fleeing a war zone. Now, see, that would be nice, too, but part of the whole thing is that the IDF gets off on eliminating people who are trapped in a small physical space, and they're not allowed to just leave, of course. But he tries to make it sound like, oh, it's just like any other war, you know, like Russia, Ukraine, people get refugees. It's like, that's not what you're saying. You're saying, like, permanently move these people to, and he suggests Ireland or the UK or whatever, he said. And then, of course, comparing Gaza, you know, to 2 million plus people, to being an infection. And then he also just says that they're all evil. Like, it's the mask slipping bit by bit until just completely falls off. And I mean, the mask was barely doing any hiding to begin with, but he's like, oh, it's just a normal thing. And when you have an infection, you've got to get rid of the infection. So you got to get rid of these people. And the interviewer challenges him on this a bit. Like, he without saying it explicitly, he's like, you sound like a Nazi. He's like, doesn't this type of speech bother you, especially as a Jew? No, it doesn't bother me. And the only dark historical thing I'm thinking about is what they did on October 7th. So it's just, you know, he just doubles down and pleads the 7th, as it were, pleads October 7th as a justification for anything and everything, especially the worst shit you can imagine doing to other people. So yeah, these fucking awful people, there have been clips kind of like disseminating in my like corners of the internet about this the last week. There's another one, I don't know if I saved it, but it actually reminded me of the reporting that Abby Martin did like years ago, where she would just interview Israelis on the street and they would be extremely candid about their opinions about Palestinians, and would just like, with a smile on their face and like giggling, and they're just like acting like it's nothing. Like, I think we should kill them all. I think they all need to die. It was pretty much just like two nice Jewish boys, but like, I mean, I'm sure it wasn't every person she stopped on the street, but she said it was like the majority would answer that way. Anyway, the clip I believe was also from this settler event where they're just like greedily eyeing this land and like are just like, hurry up, exterminate the fucking people so we can move in there. But yeah, some girl just like very, very casually was just went off about, you know, we just need to kill everybody. We need to kill them all. And it's that simple. And related to this, there's a kind of recent documentary release that focuses on Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, the two possibly worst of the worst people in all of Israel, just very openly calling for genocide and ethnic cleansing, and they have very prominent positions, fairly high up in the government, and their right-wing coalition is definitely working in tandem with the supposedly, you know, less right-wing but still right-wing Likud party, Netanyahu. There was a very telling moment where Smotrich just says very clearly that the Jewish state should extend to Damascus and beyond. I'm not going to play the clip because he's speaking in Hebrew, and I think the interviewer is maybe speaking in German or French. I didn't watch the whole thing, but the documentary seemed pretty decent. The interviewers were, I mean, they weren't pushing back too hard in what I saw, but they were definitely, like, I mean, the name of the documentary is, like, it's just called Extremists in Power. I think that's even, like, underselling it a bit, but, you know, I think they're coming from a somewhat critical angle, but it may be that critical angle where it's like, well, there's some crazy guys in Israel, in the Israeli government, but they're not all this bad. Like, here's the freak show, but don't think they're all like that. But the fact is, yeah, they might not all be like that, but there are many more. It's not just the two of them, and we see them go on TV all the time, and especially when they're speaking in Hebrew, they really let loose and say what they're really feeling. Netanyahu's holiday home was nearly attacked by a drone that Hezbollah claimed responsibility for. Better luck next time. And I think Netanyahu came out with some, like, tough guy video being like, you want to come at me? We're gonna fuck you all up. I didn't actually watch it. I think I saw it on mute. So it was just like, I can't even fucking listen to this guy right now. But an interesting thing about his house is that it's stolen. And not just in the greater sense that all of Israel is stolen land, but like in a more specific way, we can put a name to the guy. It's a Palestinian doctor, forgive my pronunciation here, Tawfiq Kanaan, and his family lived in this house. It was revealed in an Israeli newspaper that this family was just booted out illegally, and Bibi lives there now. Very nice, very cool. Exactly what we should expect from these people. So that's the settler corner. Let's go into the atrocity loop, as I've titled it here, segment. Just getting that feeling of, like, things on repeat, and they're, like, the worst things you can imagine a lot of the time. But first up, leaked document says IDF used white phosphorus in attacks that injured 15 UN peacekeepers. Whenever this white phosphorus thing comes up, it's just like, I've seen multiple videos and photographs of what is clearly white phosphorus being rained down upon Palestinians. But sometimes it gets talked about as like, that's blood libel. They don't use white phosphorus, blah, 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 you know. I mean, why not just own it? It doesn't matter. No one's going to do anything to you. Every day you break like 10,000 fucking international humanitarian laws. Just say, yeah, we got white phosphorus and we need to use it. We need to. But, so I've been talking about for the last couple of weeks, first it was, there was a standoff with the Irish group of, UNIFIL workers, peacekeepers, and then there were, just outright attacks on Indonesian and Sri Lankan peacekeepers, but this latest document that was leaked adds on to that pile and adds in the white phosphorus angle. And this was in the Financial Times. I don't know why the Financial Times is like, I'm finding multiple times now that they're doing half decent reporting on this stuff. I just wouldn't expect that from any media source called Financial Times, I guess. But maybe I need to look into their history, what they're all about. So, Israel's military forcibly entered a clearly marked UN base and is suspected of using the incendiary chemical white phosphorus close enough to injure 15 peacekeepers. According to a confidential report outlining a dozen recent incidents in which the IDF attacked international troops in Lebanon. So, a dozen attacks, and they keep claiming, "We're not attacking anybody." BB's like, we told them to get out of the way. We're not attacking. Hezbollah is using them as human shields. The report, prepared by a country that contributes troops and seen by the Financial Times, underscores how Israeli troops have targeted UNIFIL, the UN-mandated force deployed along the de facto border between the countries on multiple occasions. They have damaged several facilities and caused injuries to troops stationed at border posts in southern Lebanon. UNIFIL has called these incidents a flagrant violation of international law. Israel has rejected accusations that it deliberately targeted UNIFIL since it launched its ground invasion into southern Lebanon in the early hours of October 1st. The Israeli military had not responded to a request for comment by publication time. Shocking. Israel has also said that UN... That it's almost like me saying, man, Israel didn't get back to heat death of the universe in a timely manner. I reached out to them. I was polite and everything. Israel has also said that UN forces are being used as a human shield by Hezbollah fighters, which it is fighting near several UNIFIL posts along the border. It has demanded the UN evacuate its peacekeepers from southern Lebanon for their own safety. UNIFIL and the 50 countries that contribute troops to its ranks have unanimously refused. The attacks have drawn international condemnation, but Israel has stood firm. I bet you could find those two sentences all over the place. I might even just start to search them. The attacks have drawn international condemnation, but Israel has stood firm. On Sunday, UNIFIL said an IDF bulldozer deliberately demolished an observation tower and perimeter fence of a UN position in Marwan. UNIFIL has made public most incidents referenced in the confidential report, but it provides further details and includes photographs documenting the extent of the damage done to bunkers that shelter troops, perimeter walls, and observation towers at several bases. While incidents in the first few days were mainly near UN positions, the report says Israeli forces began directly firing onto UNIFIL bases after October 8th. And then there's some images here. You can see, like, how a tank fired at one of the watchtowers, and there's this giant hole in it, which caused it to fall afterwards. And there's a picture of what appears to possibly be the white phosphorus, just kind of like cloudy in the air. I mean, I think white phosphorus affects people in a pretty distinct way. I think that would be the evidence that you could use to prove that they use white phosphorus. The early hours of October 13th, UNIFIL said two IDF Kava tanks broke through one base's main gate. Following UNIFIL protests, the tanks left after 45 minutes, but within an hour, several rounds were fired about 100 meters north of the base, which emitted, quote, smoke of suspected white phosphorus that wafted into the base, the report said, injuring 15 peacekeepers. The IDF acknowledged that one of its tanks had backed, quote, several meters into the UNIFIL post, but it said the tank was trying, under fire, to evacuate injured soldiers. The IDF added a smoke screen had been created to provide cover. Even if clashes occurred in the area, those tanks, quote, can withstand fire better than our position can. So if they were sheltering, it wasn't for physical shelter, said a UNIFIL source. Yeah, no shit. What are they talking about? It just sounds like such a fucking the dog ate my homework kind of like lie, or like making up a fucking book report on the spot, except with tanks and white phosphorus. Rights groups have documented Israel's use of white phosphorus in Lebanon throughout the past year. Its use is unlawful in populated areas under international law, but it is frequently used as a military tool to obscure or as a weapon to smoke out opposing forces. Israel has previously defended its use of white phosphorus as consistent with international law. How does that work? There were no people there. We don't consider them people. So the white phosphorus is cool. Yeah, you got it? Caitlin Johnstone had a good tweet about just how endlessly the IDF kills UN and other aid workers in record-breaking numbers. She wrote, "It's gotten to the point where the only advantage to sharing your coordinates with the IDF as a humanitarian aid organization is that it will allow the historical records to show that they knew exactly what they were doing when they killed you." Yep, pretty much. It's happened so many times. So many ambulances, so many aid trucks. They go about it all the right way, all the way that Israel wants them to, and telling them your plan basically just allows them to better fucking target and kill you. We've seen this happen over and over again. The atrocity loop keeps on looping. I touched on this last week, I think, as well, but it happened again. Israel demolishing entire villages in Lebanon. This shit just boggles my mind that, like, eyebrows aren't raised at this, and that, like, I think Matt Miller was confronted with the one that I talked about last week, and he's just like, yeah, that was terrible, that was awful, but, you know, I can't really speak to that, I don't really know, Israel maybe had a good reason to do that, but, you know, it was a real tragedy, and then it just fucking disappears. But yeah, they're just like wiring up entire villages and then exploding them, and they did it again. I mean, by the time this episode comes out, they may have done it a third time. And all the times they've been doing this in Gaza, so many, and they always get uploaded to Instagram or TikTok or whatever as well. But yeah, you can see the videos, you can see the pictures, like the pictures that are just, like, I don't know, really awful to look at in some ways are, like, before explosion and then after. And, like, you can really see the extent of the destruction. And it's, I mean, and I don't even know if, like, people are in these places. Like, I guess when they're wiring it up, they would presumably, I mean, I wouldn't put it past these fuckers to, like, just tie people up and then, like, keep them there and then blow the fucking place up. But I don't even know. And then, like, I don't know, it's insane, the shit that you can see on the internet these days. Like, I just, like, scrolling by and I see a fucking giant missile just collapse an apartment building. Like, but someone was really close to it. Like, a bunch of people were really close to it. And someone, like, I don't know, got it in high def. Like, they were just, like, filming otherwise. And it's just a crazy thing to see. And crazy is an insufficient word, but I'm tired. the demonic freak who left that comment is a former CNN producer. So I saw a tweet which was showing a little girl, couldn't be older than 4, 3, 2, Jesus, missing her legs and crying. And this CNN producer felt the need to leave a comment beneath this picture that says, "I am horrified and terribly sorry, but what did you think it's going to happen after you attacked Israel on October 7th, 2023? Who are you talking to, the little girl? Like, who the fuck are you talking to?" Ugh, Jesus. Thomas Etzler, Etzler. I'm not saying, but I'm saying, I don't know, say some mean shit to him. whatever else you can think of. And speaking of little amputees, Jesus, it's a sentence I never would expect I would have said before. Side by side headlines here. From the Jerusalem Post, despite the war, Israelis seek solace in cosmetic procedures, with 54,000 aesthetic surgeries and 30,000 facial injections performed last year, alongside crucial treatments for conflict victims. Plastic surgery on the rise since Israel-Hamas war. Next to that, and in the image there is just some, like, I don't know, stock image of a lady getting a fucking injection in her face. Next to that, for comparison's sake, a girl with only one leg now using crutches to walk down a hallway. And above that, it reads, Gaza now has the largest population of child amputees in the world. So, that's an interesting comparison. Interesting is the word. Fascinating. It really, it's making me rub my chin and furrow my brow. Next section, accusations, confessions, human shields. You know what? I'm going to skip this one because I've already gone on and on about how Israel uses human shields, but yeah, it's information that I think needs to be disseminated further, because it's like, I feel like it's undeniable, although I'm sure I would find that, you know, the most fervent Zionist would be able to somehow dismiss it, but it's just, the evidence is so strong and so lacking for the other accusations about Hezbollah and Hamas doing such a thing. Israelis doing tropes on themselves? I gotta shout out to some of my TrueAnon subreddit pals. Congress baseball fan, user Congress baseball fan, whose name I did not understand. It took me a while to figure it out, but once I got it, I was like, ah, I see what you did there. It's fucking clever, and I'll let you just chew on it a bit. What would someone in a radical far left subreddit, like the TrueAnon subreddit, mean by Congress baseball fan? They posted the following. So, can we take a break to laugh at Israel bombing a bank that gives out interest-free loans? To which I answer, yes. Yes, we can. So, yeah, Israel has begun attacking financial institutions, banks, in Beirut and maybe Lebanon more broadly, because they say that they are funding Hezbollah. But the one they targeted, I don't have the clip ready, but I can just explain it. The reporter was explaining, like, this is like a community bank that gives out interest-free loans. And, the joke here, the doing tropes part, obviously, is the Jewish state is not pleased with interest-free loans. But, furthermore, shout out to user Girl DeBoard, another great user handle, by the way. I'll say, if you're not picking up what they're putting down with that username, Girl DeBoard, look up a little monograph called The Society of the Spectacle, and it may shed some light. They posted here, my fucking god, Israel is a racist Nick Mullen fever dream joke of a country. And this is in relation to a second bank they are interested in. Yes, they did blow up these places, just annihilated them. Because they're defending themselves, guys. They're defending themselves from the interest-free banks. Interest-free loan banks. So they blew up multiple targets, I think multiple branches of the bank called Al-Qard, Al-Hassan. 15 buildings were struck in total. Jesus Christ, these fucking people. Oh, but here's the nice part. They're humanitarians because they did warn people. All I could see is how they warned them is that it said they warned them in Arabic. Very nice of them. Different from what Bibi's been doing when he talks to the Lebanese people and only speaking in English. They sent out messages in Arabic on the internet. I don't know what that means. I don't know how far reaching that is. I'm certain people probably died or were horribly maimed anyway. So yeah, they blew up a bunch of like financial institutions, in particular this one that is like literally just a community bank, and it doesn't even fucking matter. If these were called like the Bank of Hezbollah, they'd be equally outside their jurisdiction, we'll say, to be just fucking blowing up banks or anything, really. I mean, obviously. But the funny part, they did come to one, they came to one bank that they spared. They spared one bank because that bank, they believe, has a bunch of cash and gold in it. And now they have it in their sights as, but they said explicitly, like, we're not going to attack it, but we know what's in there. And then they released another one of their hilarious, like, shitty CGI things that's supposed to convince us that they have proof of something. Just like they had proof of all those huge fucking missiles and rockets and shit in the 6 apartment buildings they destroyed on the first day that they, you know, illegally entered a sovereign nation. But why didn't they show us those later? I mean, they blew up the whole fucking building. We should have been able to see them, like, exposed. Like, all these missiles. In their CGI thing, there were, like, at least 12, 20 apartments just with military, huge military equipment in them, which Bibi said is pointed at Israel, as if, like, they're just gonna, like, fire off a fucking missile from someone's bedroom, like out the window, like, open the window, let's fire this fucking missile out at Israel. Oh, Jesus. But yeah, nobody asks those follow-up questions. It's interesting that. But yeah, so again, doing tropes. Fuck this bank that has interest-free loans for the community. Oh, this bank has gold bars in it. We'll leave that one alone. Although they still are, like, fear-mongering about it. They're like, what did they say? They said they called on the Lebanese people to go into the basement of the bank, which they had shown on their stupid CGI thing. They're like, take back your money from the bad Hezbollahs. I don't think any of that has panned out yet. Doing tropes. You troping on yourself, Israel. You are troping on yourself. Zionist narcissism plus self-pity. There's a little phenomenon that they've, this was coined in Israel, that in English it translates to shooting and crying, which is also the preferred method of masturbation throughout Israel, but that's not what I'm talking about right now. This is, I'll just read from Wikipedia to summarize it faster. Shooting and crying is an expression used to describe books, films, or other forms of media that portray soldiers expressing remorse for actions they were ordered to undertake during their service. It has often been associated with a practice that some former IDF soldiers follow. Gil Hochberg described shooting and crying as a soldier being sorry for things I had to do. This non-apologetic apology was the self-critique model advanced in Israel and many politically reflective works of literature and cinema as a way of maintaining the nation's self-image as youthful and innocent, along with its sense of vocation against the reality of war, growing military violence, occupation, invasion, and overall sense that things were going wrong. And there's just a few more, like, academics talking about it. This one lines up more with how I would feel about it, I would say. Amir Vodka, cool name, wrote, "It typically depicts the IDF in a critical light, as a traumatizer of young soldiers. Yet the genre itself is often criticized for turning the assailants into victims, and in a sense, allowing the continuation of a war under the guise of self-victimization." Indeed, see a lot of that, and we're going to see some more right now. Both The Cradle and CNN, two very different publications, The Cradle being a good one, of course, CNN being horseshit state propaganda, on this idea that IDF soldiers are sad. They're getting sad these days, basically. As I wrote here, CNN did a story on this subject, which, unlike The Cradle, of course, 100% took the side of the crybaby soldiers and without an ounce of judgment, published this disgusting, self-pitying, and proud admission of psychopathic violence. The psychopathic violence I'm referring to is in the quote from this soldier. The soldier named Guy Zakin, whatever, co-driver of a bulldozer, provided further insight into their experience in Gaza. "We saw very, very, very difficult things," Zakin told CNN. "Things that are difficult to accept." The former soldier has spoken publicly about the psychological trauma endured by Israeli troops in Gaza. In a testimony to the Knesset, Israel's parliament, in June, Zakin said that on many occasions, soldiers had to, quote, "run over terrorists dead and alive in the hundreds. Everything squirts out," he added. Zakin says he can no longer eat meat, as it reminds him of the gruesome scenes he witnessed from his bulldozer in Gaza, and struggles to sleep at night, the sound of explosions ringing in his head. Who made those explosions, I wonder, most of them? When you see a lot of meat outside, and blood, both ours and theirs, Hamas, then it really affects you when you eat, he told CNN, referring to bodies as meat. Then he goes on to launder his image slightly, or try to. And he says, he maintains that the vast majority of those he encountered were, quote, terrorists. Then he says, "The civilians we saw, we stopped and brought them water to drink, and we let them eat from our food," he recalled, adding that even in such situations, Hamas fighters would shoot at them. Then he says, to completely contradict what he just said about being nice to the citizens, "So there's no such thing as citizens," he said, referring to the ability of Hamas fighters to blend with civilians. So what is it? Why would you share water and give food to people that you are almost positive are just terrorists in hiding? And then to say there's no such thing as citizens, that's echoing exactly what the fucking president of Israel said at the beginning of all this shit over a year ago. There are no civilians. They should have risen up and overthrown Hamas, and they didn't, so here come some bombs. I don't want to read any more from the fucking self-pitying fucking bullshit, but it's, the CNN article is just like, I don't know, it's fucking infuriating. That's all I'll say. But yeah, the meat thing was particularly, I don't know, stood out. Next segment, economic collapse, huge numbers fleeing. I'm gonna skip this, save it for later. Mark that. Alright, this other thing that I've been trying to bring into the podcast for the last, I don't know, a couple of weeks or something. The Samson option. What is the Samson option? Some guy named Keith Woods, appears to be Irish, whatever, lists himself as top 200 most influential X users. Anyway, he had the following post about the Samson option. If Israel is ever threatened with complete destruction, it has a contingency plan to try to wipe out civilization in a nuclear holocaust, targeting, quote, pillars of civilization like European capitals and Islamic holy sites. A final act of vengeful hatred against the world for anti-Semitism, in quotation marks there, anti-Semitism. Bloodthirsty psychopaths, misspelled, but whatever. And then they have some. I hate when people don't attribute shit. It really drives me crazy because anyway, they just have a screenshot of some article or book or something, and those highlighted passages here, and I searched like exact sentences from it and couldn't find anything. But anyway, whatever this source is says, and then there's another route from regional to global nuclear conflagration, the Samson option, a term first popularized in a 1991 Seymour Hersh book by that name. I kind of want to read that book. That's the scenario under which, in the aftermath of a second Holocaust, who's the perpetrator here? Israel's surviving submarines, reportedly five German-made Dolphin-class submarines, would use their nuclear-armed missiles to do more than retaliate against Israel's specific attackers, but would use their nuclear missiles to bring down the pillars of the world, attack Moscow and European capitals, for instance, on the grounds that their enabling or toleration of eliminationist anti-Semitism made both the first and second Holocausts possible. Indiscriminate vengeance that might even extend to the holy places of Islam. I would assume so, considering Israel's record, a nightmare scenario feverishly discussed on the internet for some time, in retaliation for the hatred that brought about a second Holocaust. Abandonment of proportionality is the essence of the so-called Samson option in all its variants. Abandonment of proportionality is the essence of Israel, I would say. A Samson option is made possible by the fact that even if Israel has been obliterated, it can be sure that its Dolphin-class nuclear missile submarines cruising the Red Sea, the Indian Ocean, and the Persian Gulf at depths impervious to detection can carry out a genocidal scaled retaliation virtually anywhere in the world. It's making me feel real good to know that Israel has all these nuclear capabilities. It is probably unnecessary to recall the origin of the phrase. Samson's suicidal dying act in the Bible was to pull down the pillars of the Philistine temple around him and kill all those inside, including himself. The extreme version of the Samson option presupposes a rage on the part of the post-second Holocaust survivors in possession of nuclear weapons determined to reduce the entire temple of civilization to ashes for having complacently allowed two Holocausts to be inflicted on one people. Yeah, imagine if one people went through a genocide multiple times. Can you even... I found another interesting thing about the writer Günter Grass. I assume that's how you pronounce his name. I never really heard anyone say it out loud before. German writer. He wrote this poem in 2012, and it's basically about the danger of Israel having nuclear weapons. And people naturally flipped out about this, called him an anti-Semite, blah, blah, blah. I mean, he was a member of the Waffen-SS, which he admitted in 1999. I'm pretty sure he's a repentant Nazi. I don't know. I don't know much about Günter Grass. But anyway, poem is too long to read all of, I think. But some parts of it I can relay. It was called What Must Be Said. Why have I kept silent, held back so long, on something openly practiced in war games, at the end of which those of us who survive will at best be footnotes? It's the alleged right to a first strike that could destroy an Iranian people, subjugated by a loudmouth and gathered in organized rallies, because an atom bomb may be being developed within his arc of power. Yet why do I hesitate to name that other land in which for years, although kept secret, a growing nuclear power has existed beyond supervision or verification, subject to no inspection of any kind? This general silence on the facts, before which my own silence has bowed, seems to me a troubling and forced lie, leading to a likely punishment the moment it's broken. The verdict, anti-Semitism, falls easily. But now that my country, brought in time after time for questioning about its own crimes, profound and beyond compare, has delivered yet another submarine to Israel in what is purely a business transaction, though glibly declared as an act of reparation, whose specialty consists in its ability to direct nuclear warheads towards an area in which not a single atom bomb has yet been proven to exist. Its feared existence proof enough, I'll say what must be said. And it kind of goes on like that. Basically, he talks about being sick of the West's hypocrisy, basically on how Israel is treated with completely different standards than any other nation. But then the pushback came from multiple people at the IsraelNationalNews.com. Rachel Hirschfeld wrote, German, quote, poet, Israel, quote, danger for world peace. Nobel Prize laureate Günter Grass wrote poem alleging that Israel is a, quote, danger for world peace. Israeli strike could, quote, annihilate Iran. I love when people, like, do the sarcastic voice with the scare quotes about shit that is just absolutely true. Israel could, quote, annihilate Iran, if you want to put it like that. No, it's just a fact. Everybody knows you have nuclear weapons, but you don't disclose it, which is a fucking huge crime in itself. So she just, like, summarizes the poem, but summarizes it poorly, and says that he's just, like, promoting Iran, and, like, she implies that Iran has nuclear weapons secretly, and that him saying otherwise is anti-Semitic. And then she reached out to some other person, described here as Jewish publicist Herrick Broder, lashed out against Grass, calling him, quote, the prototype of an educated anti-Semite. Broder continued to note that while Grass has, quote, always suffered from delusions of grandeur, he has now gone, quote, completely insane. It's completely insane to be worried about world-ending nuclear war. Sure. Grass always had a problem with Jews, but he never articulated this as openly as in this poem. I don't know how anyone can read that poem and walk away thinking he's saying Jews are bad. It's just stupid. It needs to be said that blood libels are a European tradition ahead of Passover, said Emmanuel Nashon, Israeli envoy to Berlin. It used to be Christian children whose blood the Jews allegedly used for their matzah. Today, it's the Iranian people that Jewish people allegedly seeks to annihilate. So they're equating blood libel, just made up stories about how Jews drink blood and use it to make their food, with the very real world hostilities between Iran and Israel. That tracks. We want to live in peace with our neighbors, and we aren't ready to take on the role in the way the Germans deal with their past that Günter Grass wants to attribute to us. So in other words, we will not reflect on our crimes and the foundational sins of ethnic cleansing and genocide multiple times in Israel's very short history as a country. No, we're not ready. We aren't ready to take on that role in the way the Germans have dealt with their own past crimes. It's just not for us. All right, enough about that. And final bit under the umbrella of Israel, Lebanon, and Iran is Uber for genocide. Got two good articles on this here. Which one should I... I'll just go with the one I read first, which is from the drop site. But The Cradle also had a new, which is in the show notes, which you are welcome to look at. Go to that episode description and scroll down a little bit, and you'll see show notes. Click it. Takes you to a Google document. The Israeli-American businessman pitching a $200 million plan to deploy mercenaries to Gaza. Or as The Cradle puts it in their headline, with a bit more strength to it. Israel sets in motion plan for Gaza concentration camps run by CIA-trained mercenaries. Maybe I will just read from The Cradle one instead. I mean, drop site's good too. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's cabinet is expected to approve a plan to establish concentration camps in Gaza, operated by mercenaries from a private security firm run by former U.S. and Israeli intelligence officials and special forces commanders. I don't know how to pronounce this. This newspaper, this Israeli newspaper, Yedioth Ahronoth, reported this on October 22nd, and they have a link there to it. The U.S. security firm GDC plans to establish humanitarian bubbles, so-called, in Gaza. The Israeli army will be tasked with clearing any such bubble of Hamas fighters and erecting a separation wall around it within 48 hours. Entry to these compounds will be prohibited except for residents who live in the neighborhood and submit to biometric identification. This doesn't sound dystopian at all. Regarding the plan, U.S. journalist Dan Cohen, shout out, he writes for Mint Press News, he's very good, reports that, quote, the Biden administration has approved the deployment of 1,000 CIA-trained private mercenaries as part of a joint U.S.-Israeli plan to turn Gaza's apocalyptic rubblescape into a high-tech dystopia. GDC is headed by Israeli-U.S. businessman Moti Kahane, who worked with Israeli intelligence during the war on Syria to supply extremist so-called rebel groups seeking to topple the government of President Bashar al-Assad. Yeah, those so-called rebel groups, I love the word that the U.S., the West broadly, would use to describe them. These were like fucking Al-Qaeda and ISIS operatives. They called them moderate rebels. That was also the name of the podcast that Ben Norton and Max Blumenthal had together before they broke up. And then they have a tweet here from someone called Boltzmann Booty about this. And they have a picture of that guy, that fucking awful guy we talked about on the podcast, I don't know, months and months ago probably. Stuart Seldowitz. That old piece of shit who is like caught on camera just like harassing food cart workers in New York if they like looked vaguely Arab or whatever. Anyway, he's got something to do with this. An Uber for war zones run by an Israeli American intending to create private biometrically secured communities in Gaza in partnership with a Blackwater successor and employing this insane former Obama admin guy that used to go around screaming at Arabs working in food carts. That's Stuart Seldowitz. So he'll be working alongside a Blackwater successor and this Kahane guy to make this dystopian dream come true. Yedioth Aronoth, the Israeli newspaper, reports that GDC has participated in various Western-backed wars, including in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Ukraine. It is active in about 100 countries and employs more than 14,000 people. The company employs former fighters in elite units of the U.S. and British armies, as well as Kurdish fighters. These mercenaries are supposed to secure the humanitarian convoys that will enter each bubble. The company believes that about 100 mercenaries will be needed to, quote, secure each neighborhood, quote, bubble. GDC will start operating within 30 days from the moment of approval, and the Israeli arm of the company will be entrusted with coordinating the activity of the Israeli army. Among the Israelis involved in the project are Major General Doron Avital, Brigadier General Yossi Koperverser, and the former commander of the Navy, David Tsur. Justin Sapp, a retired U.S. Green Beret colonel with nearly 30 years of active duty experience, also helps guide the firm. Funding to imprison Palestinian residents of Gaza in the concentration camps is expected to come from the U.S. government and donations from abroad. Naturally. Daddy, I need more concentration camp money. Fucking spoiled little brat. The plan will first be implemented in northern Gaza with the intention of expanding it to the Netzarim Axis in central Gaza and the Philadelphia Corridor on the Egyptian-Gaza border area. The plan to establish, quote, humanitarian bubbles in Gaza comes as Israel's campaign to exterminate, starve, and ethnically cleanse hundreds of thousands of Palestinians in the north of the Strip reaches its 18th day. What a coincidence, right? As people are being truly cleansed more than ever, we're already setting up shop. We've already got these fucking families camping out along the border singing songs and shit. Which, by the way, if you look further into that Channel 4 coverage, the interviewer tries to talk to Ben Gavir, who's there, like, dancing and screaming like an idiot, and to some other awful, awful person in a high government position, minister of... She was the Minister of Social Equality, I swear. And I just can't remember her name. And she was, like, a fucking nightmare to talk to as well. But, yeah. So, if you're curious for more about the people just lining up, drooling like cartoon wolves, waiting to get in on this shit. Give me that Gaza! Give me more land! Now, believe it or not, I have news items... And I skipped over two chunks of what I had about Israel, Lebanon, Palestine, and Iran. I still have two stories on Ukraine. One, but it requires like three different articles to go through from Russia. This one I can just talk about, I can just say happened. In Australia, Julian Assange gave his first speech since being released from hell, and it's pretty good. I mean... It's fucking sad. He talks a lot about how it's difficult for him to even, like, speak to anyone, especially, like, in public, because he's been, like, in intense isolation for so many years. It does a number on you psychologically. USA, New York Times, news analysis. Vice President Kamala Harris advisors say the empathy she has expressed for Palestinians in Gaza should not be confused with any willingness to break from U.S. foreign policy towards Israel as a presidential candidate. Don't worry, AIPAC donors. She's not changing a thing. Just... They really feel the need to, like, throw that out there. There's no worry that she might. She's shown nothing that suggests anything that, like, forget about arms embargo or, you know, ceasefire, anything. Ain't happening, obviously. Speaking of Israel being, like, the spoiled brat to America's wealthy daddy, Israel is demanding to freely operate in Lebanese airspace, violating its sovereignty. The Biden admin keeps saying they want UN Resolution 1701 enforced in Lebanon. Now Israel is making demands that directly contradict it. Assume Biden will reject Israel's demands then, right? That's sarcastic.
Israel has a right
That's
to
from
try
Asal
and
Rod,
target those
who
civilians.
Is one of the best people to follow on Twitter for sure. That's Assalrad. I'm not even sure that I said her name totally correctly, but she rocks. I really like
Israel
she,
has a
like,
right
every
to try
day
and
she has
target
a ton
those
of
civilians.
Posts very reliably good. But that was her speaking, by the way, what I just quoted there. And then she cites this Axios article that says, from good old Barak Ravid at Axios, Israel gave the White House its demands for ending the war in Lebanon. One Israeli demand is that the IDF be allowed to engage in, quote, active enforcement to make sure Hezbollah doesn't rearm and rebuild its military infrastructure in areas of southern Lebanon that are close to the border. The official added that Israel also demands its air force have freedom of operation in Lebanese airspace. This is their demand for the ceasefire. They're like, in our ceasefire agreement, we want to be allowed to continue firing from the sky and the ground. It's just, this is how they've been negotiating the whole time with Hamas as well. They just like, all right, so you're going to put down your guns. Hezbollah is going to completely be disarmed and not exist even as a political party, but we still get to fly around and bomb shit and shoot whatever we want. It's stranger than fiction, as they say. Can't make this shit up, which ultimately means, of course, it just means that no ceasefire will happen, obviously. Just like, who would ever agree to a ceasefire like that in their right mind? No one. Oh, this one here, last piece from USA, subsection In the Mouth of Madness, which is where I put all Matt Miller and State Department spokespeople things. I only have one this week. You know, last couple weeks I've had multiple, but this week, just the one. And I don't even need to play it. In fact, I think I might make some kind of like montage to play at the beginning of this episode using it, but he just came out and said Israel has the right to try and target civilians. Like, he didn't stutter, he didn't correct himself, he didn't try to clarify what he meant. He just said, just out with it. Israel has the right to try and target civilians. What don't you understand about that? It's going to be a long episode, but I'm going to try to go through this last couple bits quickly here. All of Cuba has been without electricity for 72 hours. Now, I put this on my list, I don't know, a couple days ago, maybe? 2 days ago? I should see if there's an update. It's still out, so tack on another, I don't know, 48 hours to this. It's bad. So basically, like, the whole grid is collapsed. Shout out to Heat Death Pod, user Heat Death Pod, whoever that is, at the Trudon subreddit, who said the following about this story. Mainstream media, of course, will gloat about this and blame it on socialism, but luckily Breakthrough News mentions how the criminal U.S. blockade is to blame, referring to a video, which is in the show notes, that you can find and watch. Video from Breakthrough News on this story. The entire world outside of the U.S., Israel, and Ukraine wants the embargo to stop, and every year at the U.N., Israel and the U.S. vote against the resolution and Ukraine abstains. I hate the fact that even abstaining is allowed in any sort of like these voting situations. It's such an obvious cop-out to me. Unless someone can explain it better to me, like why it makes any sort of sense. Yeah, that happens like every year, like clockwork. Like the entire world essentially is like, why are you collectively punishing Cuba still? And I mean, the answer is pretty obvious. They don't want socialism to succeed, so they'll do anything they can to make it look like it's failing. The U.S., that is. And Israel likely just goes along with it because they're the U.S.'s little lapdog. And Ukraine, the same. So prayers up for Cuba, seriously. That fucking sucks. In South Korea, 88% of Koreans think their society isn't fit for raising children, poll finds. That's a high percentage, I'd say. And a lot of it has to do with social mobility, or the lack thereof, and describes basically the reason. I mean, this becomes the reason why, like, the birth rate is so low, although that is something that's affecting countries all around the world now as well. And finally, China. This story that I've had on a list for weeks. Let's just get to it, and then we'll get out of here. Shout out. Big shout out. I don't think I've shouted out this person. Maybe I have. Joe Vibin. V-I-B-N. At the old Trunon sub. They painstakingly, like, break down and edit together the, like, spokespeople press briefings. So that's like a real community service. This is not one of those posts. This is entitled, "The Outrage! China May Have Accessed U.S. Wiretaps on U.S. Citizens. Only we can spy on our citizens." I mean, that kind of sums it all up, but there is an article to give us some more detail. But that is just literally what it is. Apparently, Chinese hackers got onto these networks and thereof an audacious espionage operation likely aimed in part at discovering the Chinese targets of American surveillance. So, they're surveilling our surveillance. That's not fair. Seems kind of fair. That's some actual tit-for-tat-ism, unlike, say, the asymmetrical warfare that is destroying Palestine and Lebanon right now. So yeah, it's not even an at what cost corner. That's just some what? China's surveilling our surveillers? Okay, my mouth hurts from talking too much. So let's close out here. Be sure to check out the episode description where you can join our Discord. You can also see the show notes and do some rating, reviewing, subscribing, if you please, and 5-star ratings, 5-star reviews will be read on the show, if that matters to you. All right, and finally, I'd like to close out, as always, with another deep thought from one of the 20th and 21st centuries' greatest minds, Jack Handy. If you ever fall off the Sears Tower, just go real limp, because maybe you'll look like a dummy and people will try to catch you because, hey, free dummy. All right, see you next week, folks. Ceasing transmission 008. Self-esteem.
The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au Clair de la Lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it?